Please discuss the significance of the arrival of the Johannes Kepler automated transfer vehicle at the station and what it will contribute to the ongoing sustenance of the six-person crew on board.
Let's see, ATV2, as we like to refer to it, is a unique vehicle for us in that it carries an enormous amount of prop to the ISS. It'll carry, when it docks, it'll have estimated about 4.5 metric tons of prop that it can burn, and then it'll have almost another metric ton of prop to transfer to ISS. And at this point in the station's life, it's time to raise the altitude of ISS to over 400 kilometers in order to reduce drag on the station. That's always been in the plan, and so this particular ATV is going to do that job for us, and that's its primary goal. In addition to that, it also brings up about 1,600 kilograms of dry cargo, including crew supplies and consumables and hardware, replacement hardware, things of this nature. And it's part of an integrated fleet of transfer vehicles that are bringing a number of items to ISS. And in fact, this year we're looking to increase the onboard consumables in particular in order to have a good supply in the 2012 timeframe when we think we won't have quite as many vehicles available to the ISS, and so this will help us get over that hump. In addition to all that, it also has about 100 kilograms of oxygen on board for us. So it's a critical vehicle for the program.
How versatile is the ATV in conducting full automated operations in its approach to the station, and then to help reboost the complex to its desired altitude from time to time?
Well, of course, I think I touched on the second one a bit already. The vehicle, the ATV vehicle itself, is from an automated docking standpoint, is very useful to us. Obviously, it comes to ISS relatively free of commands. It's a unique free fire in that respect. And then when it gets close to ISS, of course, the docking is also automated. However, the crew can command it to leave if they see anything that's abnormal, as the ground can as well. As a cargo vehicle to ISS, it's also very versatile. It carries, as I mentioned earlier, it carries prop for reboost. It carries, it can bring oxygen, it can bring water, it can bring a large quantity of dry cargo to ISS. So it's a very versatile vehicle for us.
The first ATV, the Jules Verne, docked to the station in April 2008 after a series of demonstrations designed to test its abort systems and its rendezvous capability. This rendezvous will be a direct approach to the station with no such demonstrations. How much has the ATV matured in the 3 years since its maiden flight, and how important will that be for future resupply of the station?
Well, it's very important, primarily because the time we spent doing the test for ATV-1 is window that you have to include in the overall time of the approach to ISS. The closer we can get docking to the launch, the easier it is for us and from the standpoint of scheduling its activities. From a maturation standpoint, ATV-1 performed flawlessly those tests that you mentioned. And that really was a verification step. It was verification testing, if you will, of the design. And so just like any design system or any system that you build that needs to be verified, it's a step you do generally once. You do a number of tests, but you generally do them once if they pass, and ATV passed all those tests with flying colors, so there's really no need to repeat them.
Finally, please discuss the overall contribution of the European Space Agency to the station in terms of science, crew members on board, and the ATV in providing service to international operations on the station. And if you can, discuss the significance of the arrival of Johannes Kepler automated transfer vehicle at the station and what it will contribute to the ongoing sustenance of the station crew.
It's really interesting what's happened over the years since the partnership was formed and we started building the ISS. In the early years, the U.S. expected that the shuttle would fly for the entire life of the ISS. With the decision to retire the shuttle and to move on to other systems for resupply, the ATV has become a critical part of our capability. Whereas before, it was important to have particularly the propulsion capability that it carried. Largely, it was redundant to what shuttle could otherwise fly to ISS. So when the decision was made several years ago to retire the shuttle, both ATV and the Japanese version, the HTV, became critical parts of our logistics resupply. And the vehicles that we procure in the U.S. to supply the ISS supplies basically the balance of what is remaining after the ATV and the HTV do their function. So in that sense, it's become critical to the well-being of ISS. And as we evolve ISS and keep it on orbit for many years, we will, the one thing is certain, we'll have to continue to resupply. And a consistent resupply chain is mandatory for the health and well-being and the utilization of ISS. And so when people ask the question, what do you think of, what role does a vehicle like ATV play to ISS? It's a simple answer, and it's not being dramatic. We can't survive without these vehicles, and ATV is a key part of that. And so for the livelihood of the ISS, in order to keep six crew on board and have them do all the research that we need them to do with the platform that we all built in low Earth orbit, we have to have the ATV there doing the job that we're relying on it to do. To date, it's done very well, and we'd expect the remaining vehicles to do just as well. We look forward to having it on orbit.